bounty hunters. We don't need that scum.
I'll take on any job. For the right price.
You are free to use any methods necessary, but I want them alive. No disintegration.
Hunting is a complicated profession.
Welcome in to the Carbonite Chronicles, presented by the Hyper Space. Podcasting in the 25th century, this show is dedicated to celebrating and talking about the Disney Plus mega hits, The Mandalorian, and now the Book of Boba Fett. Or the Book of the Mandalorian, or the Luke and Grogu show. I don't know what we're doing here, but anyways, my name's Matt.
I'm Jared.
Jared, what's up?
Well, you know, I can't help but notice that, you know, Mike fell into the Sarlacc again.
Is he gone again?
He went looking for that stormtrooper that was stuck down there, I think.
Oh, yeah, and we told him that was a...
I know, you know, he just, you know, sometimes he wanders off and we lose track of him.
Yeah, well, the Sarlacc's dead now. Do you think he just fell in?
He probably did. I'm sure he'll be back next week. But you know what?
What?
Mike's not here, but you know who is here?
No, who?
It is a mutual friend of ours. We have worked with her for years at this point, and she is a fantastic science fiction fan, and we really were looking forward to talking to her about the Book of Boba Fett. Her name is Lindsey. And she is here with us this evening. Hello, Lindsey.
Hello.
Hi. This
Hi,
is
guys.
Awesome. We've actually been trying to convince her to come on the podcast for a long time, so this is great.
We bribed her with free shirts and stuff.
Yes. Got a mug. I have that mug right there. You have right there.
No, this is great. Lindsey's been a friend of the podcast for a long time. And I got to tell you, folks, this girl's got some serious nerd cred going for her.
Give us some background here, Lindsey, before we dig into this week's episode.
Oh man. Well, it all started. when we talked about this before, I was like, what was the first thing that I like? It was like the nerdy thing that I liked. I think it was two things. I think it was my mom letting me stay up late to watch Star Trek Voyager.
Okay.
At 11 p.m. reruns when I was a little kid. I convinced her of that. And then we had like a gaming room where we would play. My dad got like the first thing we ever got after like Super Nintendo was an Xbox.
Nice.
And my dad got me that. And someone bought me, I don't know who bought me, Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic.
Mm. Yeah.
You guys remember
yes.
that
Great game?
Game. That game changed. I feel like it changed the course of my whole life. I love that game.
Awesome.
I feel like all the way up to Mass Effect today is probably.
Okay. See, Lindsey does wear occasionally Star Trek uniforms to work. So,
I don't know.
You do have the Picard jacket. I have seen you wear it several times.
I do have that. I do have that.
But anyway, I think it's going to be a fun conversation here this evening. And what do you think, Lindsey? I mean, you know what we think. The show so far, up to this point, I'd say up to the episode we're about to talk about, what have been your feelings on... The Book of Boba Fett, and maybe even like The Mandalorian before it.
The Mandalorian, I loved both seasons of The Mandalorian. I was into it right away. This show, Book of Boba Fett, I was really excited about. And then when the first episode, I know you guys talked about this in your podcast. The first episode did not. I was whelmed.
Yes,
I'll say I was whelmed.
You were whelmed.
I was like, I don't know.
Not over.
My sister watched. Yeah, my sister watched it, and she never watched another episode. Same with my. Parents, and I've been trying to convince them after these last two to watch it. But I honestly don't think that I liked it for like four whole episodes.
It was a real slow burn.
Yeah, I don't have the nostalgia for Boba Fett that maybe some people don't
know.
And
I don't know who you're talking about.
I was like, I don't know who, but I was like, why do I care about what he's doing? I need a reason to care about where he's going, why he's doing it. Why he's with the sand people? What? Why do I care? And then I feel like by episode four, we finally got the motivation of why he's doing it, why he got out of bounty hunting. I was like, oh, I actually think I like this guy. And what he's doing, it only took four episodes to get there.
Okay.
So that's how I was feeling about it. And then the moment I was like buying into it, I feel like I haven't seen him since.
Yes, that's correct. This show is a show that for the past couple of episodes has kind of lacked an identity.
Yeah.
Episode 5 was episode 1 of season 3 of The Mandalorian.
Yeah, I mean, Jared, I got to stop you and pause you real quick.
Oh, crap.
If you're listening to this podcast and you have not watched the recent episode.
Oh, crap.
I'm warning you now.
I got the spoiler Walkman here.
Nice.
I do prop comedy even when you can't see the video. So I'm actually holding a Walkman. Here we go.
Are you always?
Hang on. Let me see.
You will know it is time to turn the page when you hear R2-D2 beep like this.
Every time!
Okay, hang on. Let me fast forward. Okay.
Yeah.
There's a spoiler alert. Here we go.
Everything.
All will be made clear, Lindsey, in the magic of editing.
I was like, wow, he's really committing to the
bit.
A stranger comes from the desert.
Oh, man. And I think we know who we're talking about. Anyways.
That really held me on the line a long time to pay off on that.
Okay. That now, Lindsey, before we get started, have you watched the Clone Wars or Rebels?
No.
Okay. None at all.
No,
none at all.
None of them.
So let's just, we can quickly jump to the end and explain what that title means since you brought it up, because I know where you're going with this.
Yeah.
So in the Clone Wars, we got to meet a lot of really unique Star Wars-esque characters, and some were weak as hell, and some are forgettable, and some are as DNA Star Wars as they came. Ahsoka Tano being one of them. She has lived on and become an amazing Star Wars character. I think one of the better creations in the past 20 years in Star Wars. But they also had, coming in and out of that series, a bounty hunter named Cad Bane. And Cad Bane was, I always said this to Jared. I said, you know, that guy right there, that's Star Wars. They nailed it with this guy. From the look to the voice to his Clint Eastwood-esque kind of demeanor about him. I'm like, they nailed him with this guy. And every time he was in an episode, it was a great episode.
Yeah. Yeah.
He always has that hat.
He does. He always has a hat. Like, and
he looked really good.
The thing, yeah, he's obviously a Duro species, who is a species we saw in the cantina in A New Hope. So it goes all the way back to the beginning. But he does have some enhancements. And I did some reading on him. The reason he has these tubes, it's to prevent him from being force choked. Because he because he hunted Jedi. And it mechanically keeps his throat from being able to be closed.
That's some good little trivia right there. So Cad Bane, we got to see Cad Bane for the first time in live action in this episode. And I have to tell you, live action was insane in this episode. What we got to see from start to finish, it might not have been a Book of Boba Fett show, but it was one of the best live action Star Wars surprises that I've got to watch, I think, ever.
You have to understand that Matt has been wanting live action Cad Bane, I think, since it was first.
You guys talked about it last
week,
right?
And I said at the beginning of this season I would burn my house down if I saw live action Cad Bane. Fortunately, I have not done that, but when I saw it this morning and I saw that silhouette walking up the street, I may have squealed a little bit. Audibly. But Matt has been talking about this since Rogue One came out. He's like, oh man, this is a chance. I could start doing live action stuff like Cad Bane, that, you know, maybe he'll show up in Solo. You know, Matt was always holding a torch for Cad Bane live action.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. And he finally has it. And I'm happy for you, Matt.
And to have Corey Burton,
the voice, one of the best voice actors in the business, Corey Burton, he was. Lindsey, if you don't know this character, his name is Zero the Hutt. And
oh, that I definitely don't it, know that.
You want to give your best impression of him?
Of course, Matthew.
That's
my name is Zero the Hutt, and I am a purple Dayglow Slimy Hutt, and Jabba is my nephew.
Oh my God, it sounds like Pizza
Hutt. It's he appeared in the original Clone Wars movie, and in the theater, which me and Matt saw this in the theater, it was like laughter and stunned silence all at once. But
okay, real quick, because you mentioned that we saw it in the theater, it was Jared, myself, and our friend Sith Lord.
Mike Bryan. Do you remember
Mike Bryan? Who? So,
no,
so
and,
the three of us.
And Mark Talley was there, too.
Okay, so just imagine these grown men going to see a cartoon on like a Saturday afternoon matinee.
No, it was opening day matinee.
Yeah, it was an opening. It was a matinee.
The only people in the whole theater were mothers and children and then us.
So when Zero the Hutt,
nothing weird about that.
When Zero the Hutt started to talk, and he sounds like, you know, Boss Hogg meets
Truman Capote.
Yeah, our friend Sith Lord started dropping swears, going, you know, what the F is this, and what is this shit? And all the mothers and kids were looking right at us. So that's how our Star Wars Clone Wars kicked off.
We got scolded by the moms in the theater.
But Corey Burton, Burton voiced Zero, and he's done a ton of voices.
He works for Disney. He's just look prolific. Up Corey Burton someday, and you'll see everything he's done.
But the favorite voice he does is Cad Bane. And when I heard, you know, I saw him, and I was hoping, because I don't cheat ahead. I don't look at IMDb. I don't look at spoilers. I try and steer clear before the episode. And he looked up, and as he's looking up, you hear his voice. I'm like, oh, there it is. I'm happy. I can
with those teeth.
It's great.
Yeah.
But that wasn't the only live action thing we saw. So why don't we take it from the start and really unpack what we saw?
Okay. Well, the first surprise, complete surprise right off the bat, was Timothy Oliphant returning as Cobb Vanth, which made my wife very happy. She's like, you know, once your hair's a little whiter, you'll get there, honey. You'll get
Did
there.
She think that he needs to, like, eat something? He looked like he was...
Oh,
like,
yeah. He does look skeletal. And
God almighty.
When he had Boba's armor last season, it just kind of hung off of him. But he is really cool. Yeah. Whenever that show goes to Cobb Vanth and Freetown, it turns into Deadwood.
It is Deadwood.
It's just the way it's shot. It becomes a Western immediately.
Even
the music.
Cobb Vanth appears because we see some of the Pike Syndicate doing a spice deal. They've got a Camptano?
Yes.
Camptano. So the ice maker full of credits.
Yes.
And a chest of spice. And Cobb Vanth comes in, breaks that party up, basically saying, you got to get the heck out of here. There's no spice trading around here. That might work in Mos Espa, but it doesn't work here in this town. And what we see is he's real quick on the draw. He's fast. We knew he was a good shooter to begin with, but he knocks out three of them in 2 seconds, leaving one behind. So we know very few people can go toe-to-toe with Cobb Vanth in a straight-on, you know, duel and win.
True. I thought it was interesting that the Pike guy said, this is worth more than your town.
Yeah.
And he goes, well, I guess I'll just retire. Now get out of here. You know, he lets that guy go, which probably causes the problems he has later in the episode. I was thinking, dude, why don't you just... You should have just finished the job. But then we go to space.
And I have to tell you, at the end of the last episode, I predicted that we were not getting back to Boba anytime soon. That we were going to continue on with this Mandalorian journey. And you know what? Just because I'm a Star Wars fan, I'm glad we did, because what we got to see was amazing. But guys, I'm starting to feel that a little bit cheated here, that I had, this is two full episodes now, really, with no Boba Fett. I had a cameo of Boba Fett at the end. And that was the best.
Did he? I don't think
he didn't have any lines. Tamora Morrison.
No, he didn't say a word.
Okay.
So, I mean, I'm enjoying what they're giving me because it's just amazing Star Wars. But as far as the show goes, what the hell's going on, guys?
I clocked it. It was 27 minutes until we saw
Boba
Fett. And he doesn't even talk. I was watching the whole scene. I was like, is he going to? No?
I started thinking about this as less of a show about Boba Fett and more of kind of like a Marvel way. Okay, so like Captain America Civil War is titled a Captain America movie, but it's really an Avengers movie, right? And I think that's sort of what's going on here. Like, this is Star Wars, the Book of Boba Fett, but it's really just Star Wars at this point.
They haven't built any of it that way, though, which I think if you're like my sister, who was not going to watch any of this, and then season 3 of Mando comes out and she turns it on, she's going to be like, I'm sorry, what
happened? Like,
she's not even going
to
know.
Like with Marvel, you have to watch every movie to understand what happens in the next one, even if it has nothing to do with it.
I don't know if people know
that. That's a good point.
I don't know if people know.
Especially with these last two episodes, people who ducked out on the series, or unfortunately, it's become that like that because it's shifted away from being a show about Boba Fett. But, I mean, obviously they're putting the pieces on the board in a way that you're going to have to watch all of this stuff. Mm-hmm.
And that's fine. Mm-hmm. I don't mind doing that as long as that's what I'm supposed to do. And that's how I'm supposed to look at it. I'm okay with that.
Okay. But
Mandalorian continues his journey before he helps Boba Fett to go find Grogu and Luke. And he's using a beacon.
Man, every time I see R2-D2, I get emotional.
See, this is funny. So Jared, earlier when I finished the show, on our chain, he texts me. He's like, I got choked up. I saw R2. He still gets choked up every time R2 gets on screen.
I gasp.
It's just, I don't know. You know, and, you know, Lindsey, this may be the nostalgic old man talking, but it's
I know.
No, of course. But, you know, when every time I see a character like R2, who is, his appearance is not based on what an actor looks like, or because R2 is R2, and he always will be. And timeless. Yes, and when I saw him, I was just like, oh man, here we go. It's already starting. And then, you know, he has his little beacon up, and the Mandalorian calls him friend. Hello, friend. Oh. The Mandalorian's...
He's come a long way.
Yeah, he likes droids now.
Yeah, that's right. I forgot all about that. I forgot how he didn't like droids in the beginning.
And speaking of droids, Lindsey's favorite droid of all time appeared in last week's episode, the little BD droid.
I'm talking about excited. I was so excited. I was wearing that shirt. I have a shirt with BD-1 on it. I was wearing it that week before it came out.
No kidding.
Yes.
Because I noted her shirt at work, and she's like, this is my favorite droid of all time. And then that episode came out, and I was like, you're going to really like this new episode.
Isn't that funny?
But
I mean, hey, speaking of droids, I mean, what we find is the Mandalorian is now on this amazingly green planet, which is a heck of a contrast to Tatooine, I might add.
Yes.
And
thank God we're getting a break.
R2 leads him to past a few droids, like it's an ant, like ant droids, which are in a constant motion building a structure. And it's interesting because we find out that we're watching the beginnings of Luke Skywalker's Jedi school. And it's amazing to me that he's using the force to build it. Forced labor, that is.
Yes.
Because
he just puts those droids to work.
I mean, he's not doing anything. He's just sitting back, and the droids are building him a structure. And it's actually kind of neat to watch. But I did like the droids. I thought the ant droids were kind of cool, a neat little concept. But the Mandalorian is made to wait, and R2 shuts down. It's a little bit of
they
comedy
build
there.
Him a bench.
They build him a bench on. To sit.
That was really funny.
And it's not Luke Skywalker or Grogu that meets him, but we'll get to that a little later.
Oh yes. So yeah, that whole scene was amusing, and he starts to get frustrated. He goes, is anybody here alive? Can anybody talk to me? And like, nobody is. And he's like, what is this? A bench? Okay. Then I'll just sit here. Funny. And R2 shuts himself off. It's like, what?
Now I thought, okay, maybe we're going to jump over back to Tatooine for some Boba action, but we don't. And what we get is an amazing surprise.
Yeah. I mean, we should just talk about it right now because, listen, we see Grogu and Luke training. And I will say, this dude that they hired to do the deepfake, remember they famously hired a YouTuber who improved on Luke's appearance in Mando. And listen, I'm not saying it's 100% there, but it is 98% there.
Lindsey, I want to hear your take on the Mandalorian's Luke versus this Luke.
It's night and day. It was like Uncanny Valley. Why are they showing him? They could have, I think you guys said this, like hidden him behind. Like that. I thought they were going to do that this time because they kept not showing him when he would talk. And I feel like you always lose it in the mouth when they talk with these de-aging things. I was like, oh, they're just going to, he looks really good and they're just going to get away with it this time. He looks way better though, thank God. And then he talked and it still looked good. And I was like, holy crap, they really improved it.
That looked like Mark Hamill from that era.
And he sounded good too. Like he doesn't sound like that now.
Well, no, they're using that AI technology on his voice. I don't know I don't know if you guys saw. No, I know Matt did, but Lindsey, Val Kilmer did a video where he used this AI program to recreate his voice because he can't talk now.
I knew he couldn't talk, but I didn't know that he did that.
It sounded just like Val Kilmer.
The algorithm goes back and it takes bits and pieces out of all audio clips from movies and interviews, and it identifies his vocal patterns, and it then what you type will sound just like him.
So that's what they're using.
He was 99% perfect on the deepfake. I'm going to give him 95% perfect on the sound.
Well, the voice did start to sound monotone. Like, right.
I was just going to say it was lacking any acting.
Exactly. Like there was very little inflection, and I don't think it's quite there yet.
Right. It was good enough for me to enjoy it, though.
Sure. I mean, to see, there were frames when it looked like Mark Hamill was there and he filmed that. This is just a year on from his first appearance in The Mandalorian. And, you know, by next year, what is it going to be? I mean, it's pretty soon. They say within 5 years, deepfake is going to come to a point where it's indistinguishable from
It's close now.
And yeah, and John Favreau mentioned something about it in the documentary that he did, that they're going to have to start putting like digital watermarks on things so people know that this is not, you know, this is not Mark Hamill. This is recreated, because this technology will be used to resurrect dead people. You know, it's crazy.
Yep. I bet actors and like performers are going to start putting it in their like wills or whatever it is they fill out. They're like, you cannot do this to me.
That's exactly what I was going to bring up. I was going to say, you know, there are issues right now. I know with Carrie Fisher, her estate was already reaching out and saying everything digitally created is still Carrie Fisher. You're using her likeness. The estate should get a royalty. And that's exactly what I was thinking. Do actors now have to, you know, like if you're Clint Eastwood and you're going to have a de-aged or deepfake younger Clint Eastwood come on screen, then he's never there. If that's his likeness, is he getting paid?
Yes. And some
whole new structure.
There are actors who are getting high res scans of themselves and having these contracts put in place where their descendants get money.
Crazy.
for the use of their image. So
it's amazing technology.
It's
and thank God thing. It's here now, because if this show had been tried to make this 10 years ago,
it wouldn't have worked.
It would never have worked like it's working now. But we see Luke Skywalker and Grogu, and he's giving him some basic Padawan teaching of ways of the Force. And we go right back to old Grogu, who just wants to eat the world.
He loves one-eyed frogs, apparently.
Frog is pretty cool, actually.
And there was some good deep fake acting there, because Luke looks visibly annoyed at him. He's like, dude, I'm trying to meditate. What are you doing? And then, I guess to prove a point, he brings a whole buffet of frogs and levitates them and says, hey, you know, if you pay attention to what I'm teaching you, someday you could do this. I thought that was a very amusing start. I had to watch it twice, because the first time I'm just sitting there looking at Mark Hamill like this. Like,
I just watched it without my glasses on and it looked
well, there you go.
Everything looks really good.
That's the trick. Just watch it without your glasses on.
I like the Luke Grogu interaction going on. It's interesting how this is the genesis of Luke as a true teacher right here. And you know, I mentioned the green planet before, and it's just dawned on me now. I wonder if this planet is meant to be a contrast to Tatooine, to go back to like, I hate the sand.
Yeah.
It's coarse
and irritating.
Irritating. Anyways, did Luke get away from that to go exact opposite of where he's from to make this Jedi school? Because Tatooine, as we've said before in this podcast, feels like home.
Sure.
You know, has that kind of true, you know, deep down Star Wars feel to it. But this is completely different.
Yeah, I mean, it's possible he chose it for that. I don't even know what this planet is.
I don't think we ever find out.
It's not named. Although, you know, not to bring up Last Jedi on this show, but this is apparently the same structure that Kylo Ren destroys later. Because I looked at a screen grab, and it's the same layout. It's on the same hill. They're laying some track there, but... yeah, I think I think maybe he wants to be surrounded by life, mm-hmm. you know, because like he always says it's like Yoda was on Dagobah. I mean, that was a swamp, but it there was just life everywhere.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to use the Force right now, and I'm going to channel Mike.
Okay.
Who is probably being, you know, digested over the next 1,000 years at the moment.
Well, that Sarlacc's going to get hairballs.
He would be saying, I liked seeing Luke and Grogu together, but having them recreate the Luke and Yoda training montage of him running with him on his back and those kinds of things felt a little like padding to me.
Really?
A little bit. Though I enjoyed seeing it, I felt they're just kind of like, you know, showing off their feathers at the moment instead of moving me forward. But... that's just it's a little gripe. It's not much. I enjoyed seeing them, you know, recreate stuff. I'm like, all right, I get it.
So basically what you're saying is you have no soul.
I have no soul.
No, I liked it. I thought, you know, you see him with the backpack. You're like, ah, of course. Here we go. We're mm-hmm. doing this.
Mm-hmm.
And I liked his when he talked to him about Yoda.
I want to tell you about someone you remind me of a great deal. His name was Yoda. He was small like you, but his heart was huge, and the Force was strong in him. He once said to me, size matters not. That's how he talked. He would speak in riddles. Have you heard anyone talk like that back home?
It seems like it's like Luke trying to figure out more about Yoda and where Yoda
yes.
came from.
Yeah.
It's like, so where are you from? Did they talk like that? Like
when he does a mind meld, for a better mm-hmm. term, we see something that was really unexpected. We've got a little Order 66 stuff happening, and that was crazy to see.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, it raises a lot of questions for me, like, you know, who are those three Jedi who were defending him, and what happened to him? Because those clone
yeah.
troopers just bust. And if you notice, the clone troopers are pumping shots into the dead bodies. They're like firing at them while they're on the ground.
Yeah.
And so yeah. Was Grogu captured at that point? I mean, there was nothing between him and those troopers that we saw.
We don't know yet. I'm sure we'll find out at some point. His memory has been unlocked, I think.
Yes.
And I think that's the impression that we're supposed to get here, that these were repressed memories, and now Luke is kind of unlocked a little bit on him.
Yeah.
So I'm hoping we get a little more of that flashback and see who rescued him. Because... you know, I'm thinking, how do they work this in with like what's coming up? We know it's not Ahsoka who rescued him.
No. I'm
pretty sure it's not Obi-Wan who found him in the Jedi Temple, but it's possible.
Well, we know what those people were doing during Order 66, so.
But I don't know what happened to Grogu in the temple. I don't know if he was hidden. I don't know what happened. He's in his, if you look, he's in his little floating globe thing.
His pram. They call it a pram.
His floating pram. So I don't know where that pram got to, but we're going to hopefully find out. And that might be in the next season of the Book of the Mandalorian.
The book.
But,
of
but as all this training is going on, we go back to Mando, who gets a surprise visit. He
wakes up from a nap. And there's...
He's the most patient, like, patient, chill dude. He's just like, I guess I'll
He's
sleep
just like,
here.
I'm just going to rest in this uncomfortable hunk of armor that I'm
of
wearing.
Of course he is. He literally just flew across the galaxy like this in his new Starfighter. He had that nice Razor Crest where he could, like, lay out and stretch out.
Yeah, he had a bedroom in that thing.
He's got nothing but a tiny little seat where he's all jammed up in that armor.
Where does he pee? Does he have a tube? What's going on there?
He's got a vac tube right down there. That's all he can do.
Man, but... So, yeah, Ahsoka was another complete... So I had expected to see maybe Luke and Grogu, but Ahsoka was total shock.
Same. I'm excited to hear.
You know, so what do you think of Ahsoka so far, since you didn't watch The Clone Wars?
I looked it up. I mean, I've looked a bunch of it up. I'm like, oh, who is that? What is that? What's that about? And so I know what her deal is, and I really like that voice actress.
Ashley Eckstein.
Yeah, she's great.
She's super nice, and So I looked that up, I think around then, when she was at our place of business. Mm-hmm. And I was like, what is she doing? Oh, she's not. But I really like Ahsoka. I think she's badass.
Yeah, she is badass. That's a good way of putting it. There, at the end of the Clone Wars, she had some amazing episodes and interaction with Darth Vader. And then we got to see more of her in The Bad Batch. And then we got to see...
No, she wasn't in Bad Batch. She was in Rebels.
Oh, Rebels. I'm sorry, Rebels. Yeah. And that was... amazing what we saw.
Yeah,
her interaction. So she's a really neat character, and I'm curious to see where they go with the show. I don't know what direction they're gonna go.
I'll give Matt all the credit in the world. When we saw in 2008 the Clone Wars movie in the parking lot afterwards, Matt, you know, I was sort of like, oh, she's like this annoying teenager, you know, why does Anakin need a Padawan and all this? And Matt's the only one of all of us who went who saw the potential there. He's like, I think she could end up being a very interesting character. Like, what happened to her? Why isn't she in Revenge of the Sith? Where did she go? Does she die? And I told when I had my marathon discussion with Ashley Eckstein at work, I gave Matt all the credit. I was like, my buddy Matt, he was behind you 100% from the start. And I wasn't there yet. But, yeah, it's crazy to think that, you know, from 2008 to now 2022, would you ever think you would see in a scene young Mark Hamill standing next to a live-action Ahsoka?
It's amazing.
And her telling him, you're just like your father in that way. Like... What?
I know. Think about that, right? I mean, next to seeing his father for just a few minutes before he died, Ahsoka is probably the closest connective tissue that he's ever had.
And I want to hear them talk about that. I want to hear
too quick,
because she spent in the Clone Wars a lot of time with Anakin. Like next to Padme, I mean, she was like, you know, like his sister. And they shared a lot, and, you know, she knew all his secrets, and, you know, it got even more heartbreaking when she pieced together that he was Darth Vader later in Rebels, and they had a confrontation, and her whole story has just been really great and totally unexpected. But, you know, I think Rosario Dawson has gotten better at the role since she did it in Mando. I mean... She did a few things that, like when she playfully kind of rubs R2, like in the Clone Wars, her and R2 were very affectionate. Like she loved R2. And there was a little bit of that kind of spilled over into this performance. Because, you know, you saw her playfully kind of rub his dome and, you know, like scratching him behind the ear. and other little things like that. So I think she's... And I know her and Ashley Eckstein talk, and I think she's gotten a better, she's gotten more of a grasp on the character since last year. So I'll be interested to see her, of course, in her own show whenever that comes out. Because I think there's like 873 Star Wars shows coming out. So
it's insane.
Yeah, wasn't that a Cassian Andor show?
That's coming out this year. here's what's going to happen. Obi-Wan Kenobi is coming out. They haven't announced it, but May the 4th is a Wednesday, and that's when Disney Plus drops their shows. Obi-Wan Kenobi is dropping on Wednesday, May 4th.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I agree.
That's what it has to be. But anyway, we'll get there. We'll probably be podcasting about that as well.
Yeah, so Ahsoka and Mando have a discussion, and he basically says, I just want to see the kid, and I brought him something. So it's what the armorer made in the last episode, and he wants to give it to Grogu. And Ahsoka has a pretty good heart-to-heart with him about, you know, is it really for you or for Grogu that you're here? And Mando kind of makes that tough decision by giving Ahsoka the present to say, please give this to him. And he leaves. He leaves. And Luke and Grogu watch. And obviously Grogu, who's never seen that ship before, still feels...
Yeah, he knows.
Mando's presence is nearby.
Yeah, he reaches... That was kind of heartbreaking a little bit. And he opens his mouth a little bit like... just like that, by the way. And this is the part of the episode where I just watched it with Terry. And she's like... She started to turn on Ahsoka a little bit. She's like... She's like, look, they're not gonna. She's not gonna let him see him. And I was like, well, it's kind of his choice. And she's like, well, she put it in his head, and here we're going back now to, you know, the Jedi can't have attachments, and
I totally agree with that. I had many thoughts about that.
And we can even talk about the ending scene with Luke and the mithril vest, where he's like, okay, if you pick the vest, you'll go be with Mando, and you guys will be together, and you'll be happy. But then he has Yoda's lightsaber, which was another surprise. He's like, this is Master Yoda's lightsaber, and it's yours if you choose to stay.
It's kind of unfair.
But here's the thing.
How do you choose?
Why would you give Grogu a lightsaber?
I think he probably is like, you can get you eventually.
Yes,
I'll let you
know. Like, that kid would do damage.
You think Luke was just being like, damn, I didn't bring any gifts for this kid.
Well,
all right, well,
I was going to save this for when he turned 200.
Well, he did say, I mean, I think he tried to make a point. He's like, if you go back to Mando, You live your life in such a way that for you, a lifetime is the blink of an eye. And, you know, you will not be with him forever. But the whole time I'm thinking, man, Luke, the love of his father is what... And he yes. loves his sister, and he loves Han and yes. Chewie. He loves his friends. And that is totally separate from the weirdos in the prequels who are like priests, who are like, nope.
Yes.
Nope. You don't.
It's the reason the Jedi Order. Yeah,
exactly.
Is this shit.
Exactly.
Because
exactly.
Anakin could not legally have a wife is what made him insane.
So this is probably and hopefully a feint. Hopefully this is a test.
He's going to learn from
where
this.
He will... go with the Mandalorian and go with his heart, and that's, you know, the direction he's supposed to be.
Well, I tell you right now, he will, because they need those ratings for season 3. Because yeah. Baby Yoda is...
That little dome shaped empty where the astromech droid's supposed to be in his ship, that's where Grogu's going to sit.
Absolutely. We already heard from the armorer that the black saber was made, the dark saber was made by a Jedi who was also a Mandalorian.
Yes.
So the only one that fits that bill right now is Grogu, and I don't know how he's going to hold that giant saber, but there might be another saber in his future if it's not Yoda's.
I think, Matt, you could be right. It could be a feint, because I could not believe Luke Skywalker was saying those things. It's like after everything that's happened to him, like, you know, you're just going to banish all attachment, and, you know, hopefully they're not laying track for him to become the weird ass that he was in the sequel.
Was he sitting in his tree at night reading old Jedi texts going like, oh,
I don't think
God,
so.
God, I had no idea.
And I don't think Jon Favreau and Dave Filoni are going there.
No, I don't think so.
Not right now. But
I think we're supposed to believe.
It's a test.
Yeah, exactly.
So anyway, I just thought it was weird that they brought out this prequel dogma to to have Ahsoka and Luke start saying that kind of stuff.
I totally agree. I was like, what? And also, how does Luke even know any
well,
of that?
Well, I'm sure that...
Like, I don't think Obi-Wan was like, don't... You can't
well,
love
you know,
anybody.
We did see that Luke in the sequels had been curating old Jedi texts. And we don't know when he started.
But that
well,
was later,
yeah,
right?
Well, here's the thing. I mean, he has Ahsoka. Ahsoka knows all of this stuff.
It's true. We don't know how long
and,
they've been.
You know, she's probably told him some things.
Ooh, you think she's gonna have a Luke baby?
Oh man! Listen,
I mean,
it's
just them
Jedi.
And the bamboo. I don't know.
It's just come on. But anyway, that was a weird part for me, and it really kind of irritated me. But
well, let's jump ahead. Jump ahead because what we see is after the Mandalorian leaves the mystery green planet, he heads back to Tatooine, and the opening shot that we get as soon as he hits that desert was my favorite scene in the entire, aside from live action, amazing, was my favorite scene in the entire show, and that's when I got to see the sandcrawler with the giant crate dragon's skull strapped to the top of it.
Crazy little Jawas.
So awesome.
Did you see him like waving at him? Because they were like, hey, we helped you. Dude.
So great.
With that gigantic crate dragon skull on top.
So insane. Watch. It was so cool.
But hey, that was a great scene too. You get like this shot of, it's almost like the camera set on the wing of the ship. And it's flying, and you hear like that hot rod motor on top, like going. It's just great. It sounds like a pod racer. Or
yeah,
something.
I'm liking the ship. I'm not gonna lie, I like the ship.
Yeah, the ship's really cool. But that was a great scene. That it's just one of those goofy non sequitur Star Wars things. It's like, yeah, of course these. How do they even get it up there? That thing is giant.
It's so cool.
But then, hey, we go back to Jabba's palace, Boba's palace, and I was like, oh, hey, we're Temuera Morrison going to get to talk in this episode? No.
Do you?
But we do get
He nods. He gets
yeah,
like
he,
a nod.
Yeah, he nods at Din Djarin, and that's about it. Yeah. But we do kind of get a status report on what's going on in Mos Espa, and it's not looking good. We did see Griff Tannen's gang from Back to the Future Part 2. They were back in the war room there. Fortunately, they didn't do much. But it looks like the Pikes are really ramping things up. Mm-hmm. And it looks like we're going to have to say goodbye to Jennifer Beals.
Maybe. I don't know if she got roasted in that explosion. Flashdance could come back and make a comeback, but it was a cool scene.
I did not expect that. Mm-hmm. Like they just waltzed in there with, and you know, it was like, okay, hey, we're back here. That's cool. And then what?
I'm glad they did it. They upped the stakes a little bit. I mean, nothing really changes in that casino bar. It's always the same kind of act, so I'm glad they changed it up.
Dude, the mayor's helper is back there. He's tied up and talking.
I love
that
guy. That
was always scheduled. He was always scheduled to go off world. God, that guy.
Oh, God.
The
guy's great.
He's a bright spot. I really like that guy.
The guy's great. Really we do see Mando say, I'm going to go enlist some help. I know some people. And he kind of completes the circle of the episode and heads back and lands at Freetown, as we now hear it called. What was it called before? Most Pelgo?
Pelgo?
Something like that.
Yeah.
Most Pelgo. Right. So now they call it Freetown.
So we switch over to a Deadwood episode now, again.
Yeah. We meet a new deputy who tells Mando he can't park that
car
there.
Dude, I knew that guy was dead.
Deputy dipshit. That's what I kept calling him in my head. I was like, this
you
guy.
You knew immediately what was going to happen to that guy. He's like... And did you see the look that Cobb gave him when he came out, when Cad Bane was on the street and he walked back out and he just looked over like, what are you doing? I thought that was brilliant.
Yeah. So Mando kind of pleads his case saying, look, we need your help. You might not be affected right now in Freetown, but this is going to come at you if you don't all band together and help, help get rid of this thing. And we don't quite get an answer yet, but when the Mandalorian leaves, Cobb kind of says, let's get every fighting age man in the center of town. I want to talk to him. And that's when Showdown at Noon happens.
Yeah. I didn't know exactly what was going on when you.
I knew it the second he was standing in the middle of that street.
You knew that's who it was?
Yeah, I knew it.
I didn't get it on the first shot, but when they cut to him the second time, that's when I like audibly made sound at 4:30 a.m. in my house.
Okay, so we've already talked about Cad Bane and how awesome he is. I'm going to give Lindsey, if she doesn't know the backstory, a little bit on Cad Bane. In a cut scene that they never made for the Clone Wars, they did some kind of like...
It's like an animatic.
First level animation with the wireframes, etc. But they never quite took it to its fruition. Was Cad Bane took Boba Fett under his wing and taught him the bounty hunting kind of ways. But they later on had a bit of a falling out. And the dent in Boba's helmet, which is Beskar steel, was made by Cad Bane.
Is this canon?
Well,
not yet, because it was never put into the show. It was released as kind of like a cut scene,
They showed it at Star Wars Celebration 1 year,
right? So that's the only evidence of where that dent came from Boba Fett. So I don't think it's coincidence that he's here now, that they brought him into the show.
Boba Fett and Cad Bane are going to have words.
Yeah, that's the boss fight, I think, at the end of the show.
It could be.
Hopefully at least one word from
what?
Hopefully at least one word.
You know, Tim Morrison, they've got to, you know, make him earn his paycheck for some time. Good grief.
Mm-hmm. So Cad Bane, as you know, we found out earlier in the episode, and if you watch The Mandalorian season 2 opener, you know that Cobb Vanth is a pretty badass shot and he's a capable person. And we saw him in the beginning of this episode take care of the Pikes pretty easy. So in a classic Western showdown, it goes down to who's faster, and we learn real quick who's faster in this duel.
Yes. Well,
I blame Deputy Dipshit.
Yeah. Yeah.
He's looking at him. He's like, don't do it. I'm like, don't even look at him. Let him die.
Yes. But he shoots Cobb first, and then I think he just shoots him in the shoulder. I don't think.
Yeah, he looks like he's going to make it.
We've seen the last of Timothy Oliphant or his magnificent hair. but he gets shot in the shoulder, but the deputy, there's like four shots in the chest. I don't think there's any question what happened to him.
Yeah. I mean, I was like, what are we supposed to be rooting for here? Because I was rooting for him to go. Yeah. I was like, yep.
There was some.
He deserved that.
You know, sometimes they just cast people and you know, like, oh man, this dude, no. Mm-mm. But so, and apparently, I don't know where Cad Bane parked, but it's probably really far away because,
man,
it's like, man, and then he just starts like ambling off down the street. And it's like,
He makes a declaration that this is now a syndicate planet.
Yes.
And that everybody basically has to fall in line.
Yeah.
Okay. So here's my deal with the show. Okay. Looking at what we have to play with and what we've seen, and especially after these last two episodes. I have to tell you, I feel that the Boba Fett story now is very small, because what they just showed us in the last two episodes feels like the bigger, more important story. And now I'm back in Boba Fett world, and I feel like the conflict and everything that we're putting together just feels very small.
Yeah,
the story feels small, and it doesn't feel nearly as important as what they just showed me the past two episodes. So I'm trying to really buy into this need to get rid of the Pikes so he can be a crime lord. You know, versus like bigger things in the universe.
Yeah, like Luke starting his Jedi Academy after the like whole order was decimated. That seems like a bigger deal.
It does. Well, yeah.
I mean, you're going to show me, you know, Luke Skywalker and Ahsoka and Grogu and the Mandalorian, for God's sake. And then we're going to go talk about how the Pikes want to take over the town. And
it's hard to buy into it a little bit.
It is a tonal left turn that is, it makes me scratch my head. Like, okay, so, and like we said, I like the stuff with Boba and the, you know, the Tuskens and, you know, him sort of But, you know, looking back just now, 6 weeks later, that feels like a different show we were watching.
It feels like if you're watching like Daredevil, the show on Netflix, and suddenly in like the middle of the season where you're like really into what's happening with Fisk and like what's going on in Hell's Kitchen, suddenly like that's when the Avengers attack happens or something on New York. And you're like, well, I don't care about any of this now.
Yeah.
Because this is happening. Even though when you're watching it, you care because you're invested. But
here's what I think. I trust the people making this show. And mm-hmm. I think the last episode is going to be like a barn burner. You want to see Boba Fett riding a Rancor? You're going to see it. You want to see, I don't know what else. There's going to be other things happening.
All right. So So on our chain that we've been kind of going back and forth all week, some of the key art that was in the end of the last episode saw a Sith Interceptor flying into Tatooine. That was in the art at the end during the credits.
Yes.
And Jared and I and Mike were going back and forth about that, you know, in particular. And there's a few things that we got set up in The Bad Batch and in Solo that could play in here. One, we learned about Boba Fett's sister. That was a very key component to that show.
The Bad Batch, yes.
The Bad Batch. Very key component. Her name Omega. Mm-hmm. And we have not heard of Omega, and the DNA connective tissue there is Fennec Shand, because Fennec was out to get her in that episode. And she never mentioned his sister to her at all. So we may see his sister appear.
Cad Bane was also after Omega.
Cad Bane was after Omega, correct. And also, the Sith Interceptor, the last person, well, who logically could have that Sith Interceptor, Jared?
Well, who did we see talking to Darth Maul at the end of Solo?
Who kind of took over the reins? Kira.
I did not remember her name. Glad you
Daenerys Targaryen.
That's right.
I'm not. So in the comics have subsequently established that Kira has taken over Crimson Dawn after Maul, okay. After Maul was okay. Killed.
So they recast. Do you think they recast her as an older actress?
Well, I think they could still use her if they use her.
I mean, they could.
Oh wait, I forgot. We're not in yet.
So this Solo was 10 years.
Maybe.
So this would be.
Yeah, I get confused yes. with the timeline.
So, it might actually play in pretty well.
She would be about 20 years older than she was in Solo, but you could easily pull. I mean, God, like we were saying, Ming-Na Wen is 58, and she looks 30. So
she looks what the amazing. Heck?
So, you know, and it's Star Wars, so people maybe age different.
I think I was in my head imagining how old Han is in the new movies for some reason.
Han?
She's way yeah. too young.
No.
Like,
well, you mean
like, that will not work.
Harrison Ford is 78.
Like Harrison Ford now, yeah. For some reason, that's what I was thinking. I was like, I don't think.
No, no.
I'm going to give a prediction. I'm going to give a prediction. This show was billed as a 7-episode one off. Here you go. Mm-hmm. Then it's gone. I'm thinking that we're going to get a cliffhanger at the end of episode 7. That's going to set up a possible season 2. That's what I think. Because what elements do we still have out there? I think the Hutts aren't out of it. I think the Hutts are still going to play a role.
Sure.
So you may have, and the Pike Syndicate is not just on Tatooine. It's an intergalactic, you know, mess. And then Crimson Dawn might enter the picture, and you might have the whole thing set up for, you know, Boba to be entering himself into a world much bigger than what he had planned for taking over Jabba's throne.
That's true.
I think that's the only way I'm gonna stay bought into everything is if it scales up with all of this.
Well,
because like you said, just being stuck in his little town on Tatooine now, I'm like,
you have to up the stakes.
I don't care.
Yep.
Yeah.
And with the way everything, like we were talking before, the Marvel effect, the way everything is intertwined, whatever, and you know, Din Djarin is going to be in the next episode, so. The next time we see him, well, there's gonna be some reference to the events of what happens in the show next week, you know, because it's gonna be the last time we see him until Mando season 3. So
crazy.
It's at some point. I think Mike, he texted me this morning after he saw it. He goes, "They should just call this show Star Wars."
That's a great
yeah, and it's just becoming, everything is becoming so interconnected, mm-hmm. because pretty soon you're going to have and all these shows take place in the same time period, about 5 to 6 years after Return of the Jedi. They're giving us now, I think, and again, I'm playing the 1975 born person here. When I was a kid, after I saw Return of the Jedi, the only thing that mattered in my life was seeing another movie with Luke, Han, Leia, and Chewie. Like, that's what I wanted. Like, and at that time in the mid-80s, Lucas was talking about, you know, making prequels like in 10 years. But as a kid, like, I didn't care about that. I wanted to know more about what happened to them after. And I feel like now, in some crazy way, I'm finally getting some of that. Like, as a guy who's pushing 50 almost, like, my little 8-year-old self is like, hey, you're finally getting what you wanted.
It's happening.
You know, it's kind of an embarrassment of riches. I mean, but it's still fun to, and it's, you know, it's not above criticism, as we talked about today. But there's still, I think Matt calls it the sweet spot of Star Wars. And I want to pick your brain for a moment, Lindsey, because as someone who is younger than we are and a Star Wars fan, maybe not a super fan, but where did you come into it? Like, what was your like gateway drug? Your gateway
into Star Wars?
Your gateway spice.
Into the Star Wars.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. My dad showed me the movies when I was little and I liked them a lot. But I think I was more of a Star Trek kid. Really liked Star Trek and I was more into that. But then, like I said a little earlier, that video game came out, Knights of the Old Republic, and it was the first RPG. No, I was about to say, but there's just first role-playing, choice-based role-playing game that I ever played. And I was like, you can choose to be a bad guy, you can choose to be a Sith. And I got really invested in the lore of Star Wars, the planets, the guy that you can read, like everything about all those stuff. They put so much detail that you can just miss if you don't care. But they put so much stuff in there. And so I got really invested in it then. And then there was a sequel that wasn't in Japan. And then there was an MMO that was also not right. But that was the thing that got me super, super into Star Wars. And then me and my best friend went and saw The Phantom Menace in the theater when it came out. I was so excited. And I think I liked it when it came out. And then I was getting older as they were coming out. And then the second one came out. I was like, I don't know about this. And then by the time I got to the third one, I was like, I don't think I like these.
Okay.
I don't think these are very good.
Those are need time to marinate, I think. With me.
Yeah, but I still loved, you know, the original trilogy, and I actually my little cousins, I only let them watch those, and I am a prequel hater. I know some people like them.
Okay, well, that's enough from you, Lindsey. Thanks for joining us.
No, sorry,
I'm just kidding. No, that's interesting. That's interesting, but it's the connection that like me and Matt like feel to this material, as specifically the stuff that Jon Favreau and Dave Filoni are making. I just wonder, like, obviously in The Mandalorian, they connected. They hit something.
I will say, too, though, that all this new stuff that they're coming out with, like The Mandalorian, the Rogue One, all the stuff that's coming out that's new and really great, and the new stuff that's tying in the prequel stuff, is improving it in, like, hindsight me. I'm enjoying it. Because this is so good, I can like kind of put that in. I'm like, okay, and with this in mind, that becomes a better story because this makes all the stuff that I didn't like a little bit better.
Yeah.
And so I've come around, like, especially when I heard Hayden Christensen was going to be in the Obi-Wan show. I made fun of him just like everybody else did in those prequels. It was
But you were happy.
Not great. But I was like, yeah. This is going to be great.
You know, it gets a shot at redemption.
So.
But that's an excellent point because even seeing the Jedi Academy being built helps me like the sequels a little more. A little more. Mm-hmm. Like, it helps me buy into them a little more.
Yeah.
Because I'm enjoying this stuff and I can tolerate that a little
more. Because I think we all know that I don't think the sequels landed like Disney had hoped. people aren't buying Rey and Finn action figures. You know, kids are not into it, and maybe they dropped the ball. And there are parts of the sequels I really enjoy. Some of it I despise, but I think, like Matt said, if these guys, I mean, the whole thing makes me think, what if Jon Favreau and Dave Filoni had made the sequels?
What a world. There's a parallel universe where
what would have happened? I mean, the two guys who really know their stuff, you know, Rian Johnson and J.J. Abrams are having to ask Lucasfilm executives about stuff that happened in the timeline. These guys are...
J.J. Abrams is just ruining all of it. It just ruins all of it.
I don't know. I'd present a Rian Johnson myself. But hey, I you know...
Star Trek.
I like that Star Trek movie.
The first one.
Oh, man.
Anyway.
Okay.
I think whether the Boba Fett show is hitting as well as The Mandalorian or not, it's still giving us amazing Star Wars, and it's putting together things that, to Jared's point, I never thought I'd ever get to see. Yeah. So for me to be able to see this as a fan is like, I cannot not love the show. I might not buy into it as much as The Mandalorian, or might not like it as much, but I still love it all, because this is the sweet spot that I want to live in Star Wars. This is exactly where I want to be. It's right after Jedi. It's got all the familiar faces. It's got all the familiar tech, and stormtroopers keep popping up. And everyone I loved from those first three movies is here. So I'll live here all day long, and I'm happy to be here. But unfortunately, as it looks right now, we only have one more episode to talk about. So it better go out with a big bang, guys. By the way, Lindsey, thank you for being a part of this podcast today. After this next episode, it's going to be big. It's going to have a lot to talk about. And I'm really hoping they give us more than 45 minutes. I think in the end, I trust Filoni. I trust in Favreau that they're going to get it right. And they're going to tie it all together. And they're going to make something pretty special at the end here. So until then, guys.
Yeah.
Yeah, wait.
I tell you. Well, thanks again, Lindsey, for coming on. And
thank you, guys.
I don't know if I'm going to close the Sarlacc because Mike's still in it, but yeah, you know, for the purposes of this podcast, until next week, the Sarlacc is closed.
You know you can't live without this content, so subscribe to the Hyperspace Podcasting in the 25th Century. Follow us on social media, leave us a review, and join us next time as we take you into the 25th Century.